CSN International presents To Every Man an Answer, the live apologetics program that equips you to give a reason for the hope that lies within you.
If you have a Bible question or a question on the Christian faith, you can call us at 1-888-827-5276. Again, that's 1-888-ASK-CSN.
Let's get things started. Here's today's host, Mike Kessler.
Hi, and welcome to Thursday's edition of To Every Man an Answer. We're glad you joined us. Looking forward to being with you, as we always are. Every weekday afternoon at this time, we get together for about an hour just to answer questions about the Bible, from the Bible, look at what the Bible has to say about the condition of the world and what we hear in church. Is it even in the Bible at all? If you've got a question you'd like to ask us, that number to call again, 888-ASK-CSN. And we'll do our very best to give you a good, balanced answer of what the Word of God says on that topic. You know, a lot of topics are just taken with disregard to a balance in the Bible of the other verses. And thus we have tangents and different church dogmas that I think a lot of times would be eliminated if we just look all the verses that pertain to that topic. And so we just want to encourage you to give us a call. 888-ASK-CSN is the number to call. You can be part of the program today. Got some lines open. And with me, I have Greg Blanc from Calvary Chapel, Rapid City, South Dakota. Hi, and welcome.
Great to be with you again, Mike. I'm messing with some settings here, so I'm going to try and make it work. But I'm always thankful to be on. What a great day it is to have people calling in that want to know questions, want to know answers about things they're reading in their Bible. So looking forward to that.
That's great. Yeah, you look like you have jaundice. You're yellow.
I hope you're not a prophet.
No, you've got that. People that are on YouTube, Facebook, all those media outlets right now, you're going, he's yellow like a banana.
Yeah.
So I don't know. We'll get that figured out. I don't know. I'm just glad we have a good image of you. That's a good thing.
Maybe it's the Shekinah glory.
There you go. You're a governor there, doing a good job.
Christy Noem.
Yeah, yep. Standing up to the insanity of it all.
Well, she's got a track record of that. And, I personally, I'm very proud of her. You know, it's hard being in that position. I was talking to some people the other day, and it's hard to be in a position of government like that, because it's not easy to do your job and please so many different varying agendas, but she's a born again Christian. She loves the Lord. She's been in our church, I think, twice over the years. And so I would just encourage everybody out there in Tima land, pray for our governor. Please pray for Christy Noem, that she would continue to stay strong in the Lord and the power of his might.
Amen. So important. Well, again, 888-ASK-CSN sends the number to call. We're going to go to the phones. We have Miriam on the line, Boulder City, Nevada. Hi, and welcome.
Hi, I have a question. When our loved ones pass on and are in heaven, do they see what's happening to their family on earth?
I don't believe so. And I'll tell you why. Because the Bible says there's no tears in heaven. He wipes away every tear from our eye. I think if there were people able to look back into this world, I think they would have a lot of grief. Now again, through it all, through all the things, and in Revelation, we find a phrase repeated often. It says, true and righteous are your judgments. I think when we get to heaven, we will see life, godliness, eternity in a much different light than we all see it today. And I believe that will help alleviate some of perhaps the pain of our family relatives that didn't make it to heaven. Because I think we'll be able to see the opportunity that they had to receive the Lord, to have their sins forgiven, to have a great eternity. So I really believe that, and we don't find any verses where people in heaven can observe this. Now, we certainly know Satan did to God in the book of Job, where, you know, God said, you know, have you considered my servant Job? Well, the only reason, you know, he serves you is you've given him all that good stuff. You take that stuff away, he'll curse you to your face. So, you know, it's interesting that God was bragging on Job. It's interesting that Satan knew who Job was and his love for God, but we don't find human beings looking in to this earth from heaven. Your thoughts?
No, there's nothing that we can identify from the Bible that says that that they can see anything, you know, that is going on. You know, heaven's got a perfect place, and our joy would not be made full if we were observing what was going on back here on earth. And I know the desire is to stay connected to those saints that have passed into eternity and gone to heaven, but instead maybe we just focus on our reunion when we see him face to face and God makes all things new. That's my.
I hope that helps, Miriam.
It does. One quick question.
Yes.
The promises made to Abraham, it says it's for all his family in the future generations. So I figured the healing promise.
Well, I think that's, yes, it's true. I believe that's a general statement. You know, where we say, well, every single person. Unfortunately, this is a lot of what caused so much trouble when Jesus came to this earth, because the Pharisees would often say, our father Abraham or Moses taught us, in some way thinking they inherited these promises rather than being a personal relationship with God. And I believe this is a problem that many people today face, where they believe the relationship with God is something they turn on and turn off like a light switch, rather than coming to an understanding that we are his children and we can talk to him like we would talk to a father in heaven. In fact, Jesus said, when you pray, pray in this manner, our Father, which art in heaven. I think that's very, very important that we understand that personal relationship, not through a church or an organization or a denomination, but rather a personal thing. Again, we understand that every person has that responsibility to either accept Christ or reject him, whether it be a Jew or a Gentile. Your thoughts?
I think that we have promises from God that we can certainly depend on. I don't think that every promise to Abraham is transferable to those within the church. I just know that his promises are yes and amen, and we can trust him. We can trust that he's never, you know, when we have a promise that he says that he's never going to leave us or forsake us, I think that we can trust him on that. When he says that he who is in us is greater than he who is in the world, we can depend on those promises. And I think, Mike, you know, I hear you share this all the time. We need to be cautious about confusing the church with Old Testament saints, because the promises are not identical to both. I mean, as a Christian, we have incredible promises that Old Testament prophets, you know, look forward to. You know, you read through Hebrews and you realize that they were looking forward to a heavenly country, and so are we. So I think the general promises, I think they're like you said, are things that we should trust in, and we should hang our hat on expect, but not every promise that was promised to Abraham, even though, you know, you got to love the promise of of Genesis 12, you know, that I'm going to bless those who bless you and I'm going to curse those who curse you. So I say, you want a blessing? Bless the land of Israel.
Amen. Hope that helps.
Yes, it does. Thank you so much.
Miriam, God bless you. Thanks so much for the call. And if you'd like, stay on the line. We'll send you out some books, some DVDs, Movie Jesus for calling in. Great to share these things with your friends. And so stay on the line. We'll get you taken care of. Let's go to Glenn, Everett, Washington. Hi and welcome. Uh-oh. We lost Glenn. Glenn, give us a call back. We'll do our best to get you put on. Let's go to Susan, San Luis Obispo.
Hi. The Bible tells us that Jesus says that we are his sheep and he is our shepherd. How do we then respond to people that we are trying to evangelize to that are either offended by that or mock us or laugh at that they're too smart to be a sheep?
Well, the Bible says they're a sheep without a shepherd. And the idea is that there was a little boy one time in school, and the teacher stands up and she said, okay, class, Johnny has 20 sheep, and one gets out. How many sheep are left? Johnny puts up his hand and says, none. And she goes, well, Johnny, you don't know your math. And Johnny replied and said, you don't know sheep. You see, sheep follow something, and they're going to follow someone. And if you're not following the Lord, you're going to be following the things of this world, an individual of this world, the cares of this life. And so somebody said to me one time, said, you mean to tell me you base your life on everything the Bible says? And I said, well, by the nature of your question, you base your life on something. What do you base your life on? And they were kind of speechless because they weren't expecting that. Now, again, if somebody says, well, I don't like the idea of being a sheep, that doesn't change anything. You're still a sheep. You're just following something else other than the Lord. And that, I think, is where the real problem is. Greg, your thoughts?
Well, you know, I think that the world has plenty of things to persecute us over. And if they're going to persecute us because we believe in a good shepherd, you know, that's how Jesus himself describes his attribute to us in John 10. He says that that he's the good shepherd, and I willingly say hallelujah. I want to be one of God's sheep. I think what you're referring to is that most people would say how dumb sheep are, and I think I'd have to agree that they're not the brightest animal in the planet, but. Like Mike said, everybody is following something. You know, people want to say that they can be their own, they can be their own shepherd, and they can be their own master, and that's extremely difficult to do. I'm thankful that I have a shepherd that says that nobody can snatch me out of their hands, and there's probably not any good answer for them. There's a great answer for us who believe, but there's probably not a good answer for them when they think, oh, you foolish Christians, you know, you consider yourself a sheep, and we all, you know, everybody knows that a sheep is a dumb animal, and I guess we'll find out who the dummies were, you know, when we stand before Jesus as Savior, and other people would stand before him as judge. So maybe explain it in those type of terms, and what a great opportunity. You know, ask them who their shepherd is. Ask them what they're following, and hopefully it will lead to a great witnessing opportunity for you.
And you can change that gear too, where Jesus taught his disciples to pray, and he didn't say, our great shepherd which art in heaven. He said, our Father, which art in heaven. We are his children, and he is our Father. My question to a person that's not born again is, who's your daddy? Because everybody needs one. And without a father, there's no one to correct us. The Bible says he chastises those that he loves, speaking of his children. Now, if you're a child of God, you get out of line, we find God has a loving way of nudging us back into what is right. Unfortunately, for people in the world, when they get into sin, they get into it deeper and deeper and deeper until it finally kills them. Now, again, there's no one there because they haven't asked him to be there to get them out of the problems they're in, to give them wisdom and insight to come up with a way to get out of these problems. And so everybody serves somebody. And well, Bob Dylan song years ago, you're going to serve somebody. It'll be the devil or it'll be the Lord, but you're going to serve somebody. So I wouldn't let anybody put you down because it is a metaphor, if you will, sheep. He's the great shepherd. But what isn't a metaphor is he's our Father in heaven and we are his children. And so I would probably, Susan, flip it back to that and say, well, that's understandable, but now we are his children. And very clearly when Jesus taught the disciples to pray, our Father, whose father are you? Who's your dad? You know, that's the question I'd ask. Hope that helps.
Okay. All right. Yeah. Thank you.
Stay online. Send you out some books, some DVDs that might help you. Reach out to your friends. Let's go to Diane, Mountain Home. Hi and welcome.
Hi. Thank you for taking my call. Yes. My question is concerning David and Bathsheba. My friend and I were talking about it. And, you know, she said that she was having a hard time, you know, understanding that how God, you know, forgave for that sin. But, you know, the way I understand, we're all sinners since the fall in the garden. And so if you truly repent, God can forgive us for anything because he's no respecter of persons. A sin is a sin. Am I understanding that right? Yep. Or like?
Yep. The Bible says there's none righteous, no, not one. So maybe your friend's sin is not adultery. It might be lying. It might be talebearing. It might be causing dissension. It might be some other thing. It might be your language. There's none righteous, no, not one. Now, sinning doesn't make you a sinner. And I would point this out to her. Sinning proves what we are. We're all sinners in desperate need of a Savior. The book of Galatians tells us that the law, the Ten Commandments, was the schoolmaster or the teacher that showed us we needed a Savior, that we could not keep the Ten Commandments in ourselves, but that Jesus Christ fulfills the righteous requirements of the commandments, and now we obey the two commandments that Jesus gave up. Now, this is based on John chapter 12, where Jesus said, I have kept my Father's commandments, now you keep mine, love one another. Now, we find that Jesus also clarified as well, love God with your whole heart, mind, soul, and spirit. Love your neighbor as yourself. And here it is, upon these two hang all the law and the prophets. So what he's saying here is that we're not justified by keeping the Ten Commandments. We are now justified in Jesus Christ's righteous fulfillment of the requirement of the law, but now we are found in him and we are clothed in his righteousness. And when we sin, 1 John chapter 1 tells us, we have an advocate with the Father, which is Christ Jesus. He's the one that pleads our case to the Father. I died for that person. Yes, they sinned. They confess their sin and they're forgiven. All right. That's some good news. Greg, your thoughts?
Yeah, I think we all appreciate the story of David and Bathsheba because we look at young David as the giant slayer, and then, you know, we read some things about him that are far less flattering, and where he knows that Bathsheba is the wife of another man, and yet he says, go get her for me anyway. And then when she becomes pregnant and David is scheming and trying to find a way and brings, you know, Uriah back from the, from the, uh, from the battle lines, and none of that works. And I think it goes to show us that the Bible says nothing in creation is hidden from God's sight. Everything is open and laid bare before him who we must give an account. And so we, you know, our sin will find us out. And yet through all of that, we see, you know, God gives us Psalm 51. I'm grateful that Psalm 51 is there, because God says that, you know, the sacrifices of God are a broken spirit, a broken and a contrite heart. God, you know, these, oh God, you will never despise. And that's the David that I want to be like. I want to be humble. I want to be broken. I want to realize that my sin offends God. So we have to remember that even through all of that, David is known as a man after God's own heart. So when somebody, you know, somebody says, well, hey, at least I'm not like, you know, I'm not like David. And then, well, then you're...
No, but you're like you.
Yeah, but you're exactly. You're not like David, but your sin is always before you. And yeah, like Mike said, there's none righteous. No, one. All have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. And the wages of sin is death. But then in that same verse, the gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus. And so it's very humbling to know that, you know, maybe Mike doesn't sin like me, but Mike sins like Mike.
That's right.
And we all do. So just explain to her that maybe her sin isn't like the drug dealer or the prostitute or whatever sin that she thinks is horrible, but sin will keep you out of heaven. And that's why we need to follow what Jesus says, that you know, if any man come after me, let him deny himself, take up his cross, and follow me. So that's the best thing that we can encourage people to do there, Diane. Does that help?
Yes, it does. It does help. But, you know, she just said she couldn't understand how that could happen. But I said, well, I think it's because David was repented from that and was very sorry. And the Lord accepted that, right?
Well, yes. And that's a lot of it. That's why the Bible says David was a man after God's own heart. Now, understand that to God, sin is sin. And again, you have to point this out to her. The word sin means you miss the mark. Now, picture a bullseye. Archers would be out in those days, in the days of the Bible and Rome, and you would be out target practicing, and you would shoot at the bullseye. If you missed, you sin. Now, what's interesting about this word, it didn't matter if you missed the bullseye by half an inch or shot in the other direction completely. The point sin means you didn't hit the mark. So if you don't hit the mark because of adultery, or you don't hit the mark because of a lie, or you don't hit the mark because of an evil, wicked thought, this is what Jesus was addressing the Pharisees. They looked good on the outside, but on the inside, they were dead man's bones. And so this was where Jesus addresses them. And so this is why we are the ones that graduate sin. Now, why do we do that? Because we realize in this life, there are consequences for different kinds of sin. In other words, if you kill somebody, as an example, well, that's, you know, you're put in jail, supposedly for the rest of your life. Now, but a person that steals a lamp out of a department store might get a slap on the wrist and maybe a week in jail. Well, therefore, one is not as bad as the other. Well, they're all sin. They all miss the mark of what was best. We get the idea of graduated sin because of the repercussions of sin. So in other words, because something might have a very large, long-term, maybe lifelong consequence, is a much worse sin than stealing a candy bar from the drugstore. Well, it's all sin. And this is what you have to point out to her. And what is tragic is that people look and say, well, I'm not as bad as that person over there. Well, that may be true, but you're still a candidate for hell, because we don't go to heaven because we are good. And I think this is what you need to point out to her. We go to heaven because Jesus Christ is good and we are clothed in his righteousness. There is not one person in heaven that made it into heaven because they were good and because they kept all the rules and they didn't sin as bad as everybody else did. The only reason a person will be in heaven is they are clothed in the righteousness of Christ, period. Because the law will never save you. I hope that helps.
Oh, very much so. Thank you so much. I appreciate it.
God, you know, God bless you, dear, and stay online. Send you out some books, some DVDs, a little book called Time to Grow. Explains this a little bit further, and I think you'll really enjoy it. Use it for evangelism. With that, we'll go to Lacey in Wyoming.
Hi, Lacey. I am wondering if you can help me explain the Trinity Godhead to my child.
Well,
not
yes,
quite grasping
yes,
it.
We can, and you know, it is a mystery. I think it'll be a mystery till we get there. But the Bible says, as an example, in Genesis 1, let us make man in our image according to our likeness. All plural. And it is true. We are a body, we are a mind, and we are a spirit. And we know that you can have a body in perfect health, and they do this all the time, and commit suicide. Why? Because their soul is sick. Their mind is not well. So we're going to talk about this on the other side of the break. Talk about this wonderful Trinity we know as God. Coming up right after this. We'll be right back.
Thank you for listening to CSN Radio, where God's word is heard. Did you know your financial support is a primary reason we can broadcast over 400 stations nationwide? It's true. We are grateful for your partnership. As you know, our nation is battling over religious and civil freedoms. Here at CSN Radio, our listeners can trust us to be a solid biblical teaching foundation and share a Christian perspective on current times. The importance of reaching the masses is greater than ever. We need your support in this uncertain time of chaos and strife. We are excited to share that we plan to add more stations in 2023 and 2024. This means we will reach more of the lost, broken, and deceived. Mark 16 verse 15 quotes Jesus. He said to them, "Go into all the world and preach the gospel to all creation." We need your support in funding the building of these new stations. You can go to csnradio.com/donate or call 1-800-357-4226. That's csnradio.com/donate or call us at 1-800-357-4226.
Bringing songs to the Lord from the hearts of believers. To glorify and praise the name of Jesus, the Christian Satellite Network.
Welcome you back to part two of To Every Man an Answer here on this Thursday afternoon with Greg Blanc from Rapid City, South Dakota, Calvary Chapel. I'm your host, Mike Kessler, and we're going to go right back to the phones. We had Lacey on the line wanting us to define or explain what the Godhead is, manifested in the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. When we go to the book of Genesis, in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. The word God there is the word Elohim. It's not singular for God, but plural. actually speaking of three. And yet it says we are created in the image of God and we are a triune being as well. Well, at least we should be. You see, the day they ate of the tree, something died in them. That spirit has been devoid ever since. Jesus said to Nicodemus in John chapter 3, marvel not that I say to you, you must be born again. He goes, well, what do I got to do? Get back in my mom? What's the deal here? He goes, no. Unless a man is born of the water, when the water breaks out, come the baby. And the spirit, a spiritual birthday, just like you had a natural birthday when the water broke. So you need that to be born again. And so Jesus gives this understanding to this religious leader of the day in John chapter 3. Greg, you know, the Bible, all we find these pictures all the way through the Bible. As an example, Jesus, beginning his earthly ministry, was baptized. A voice from heaven saying, this is my beloved son. Then we have the dove descending in the form of the Holy Spirit resting upon him. Your thoughts?
Yeah. Lacey, how old is your son? Is it okay? Can we ask that? How old's your son?
Yeah, of course. He's about to be 13. He just isn't understanding how three can be one.
Yeah. Well, join the crowd, right? In the big picture, it's not just difficult explaining the Trinity to a 13-year-old. It's difficult to explain it to full-grown adults that have the capability of understanding, you know, a lot deeper things. I think that when we explain the Trinity to anybody, just in general, we have to be reminded that our minds are limited. And so we have to accept that when it comes to the Trinity, that we can't necessarily comprehend the Trinity, but we can apprehend the Trinity because the Bible teaches it. As Mike said, there's many illustrations where the Father is called God, where Jesus, the Son, is called God, and the Holy Spirit, the person of the Holy Spirit, is called God. If you look in your Bible, you'll be able to see that it says that the Father raised Jesus from the dead. You'll be able to see that it says that Jesus raised himself from the dead, and then the Holy Spirit raised him from the dead. So when explaining the Trinity to anyone, I think it's a good place just to remind them that God is a mystery to our limited human minds. But the Bible, you know, we have our Bible, and the Bible describes God as three distinct persons, and each person is equal, but their roles are different, and they all three are divine in nature. But where we always have to start the conversation and end that conversation is that there is one God. So I would trust, I don't think that you will probably be able to necessarily explain it to him without the power of the Holy Spirit being able to speak that truth into his heart. So take him to the scriptures. You can look up Trinity and find out all the verses that declare that each of the three persons of the Godhead are described as God, 100% God. They're not 33 1/3% God. They are all 100% God. And then ask the Lord to open his heart and to open ours. It's the same. It's the only way that we can apprehend it and comprehend it as well. Pastor Mike?
Hope that helps.
Yes, thank you so much.
I got some books, DVDs, I think will be very helpful. First of all, God of Wonders, which explains how God made everything. And God made you and got a purpose for you, just like he did for everything he made. The second one is Evolution Versus God, that shows the problems, why evolution is really, at best, a religion without any facts. And so it's very good. Then a little book called Time to Grow. And those will, I think, really help you. and then the movie Jesus, I think you'll really enjoy. So stay in line. We'll get those out to you, okay?
All right. Thank you.
God bless you, dear, and thanks so much for the call. And again, use them, share them with your friends. Now, we had a question earlier, and our caller disappeared. I don't know where he went, but he said, is the sinner's prayer real, or is that fake, or where is that in the Bible? And all I can tell you, it's kind of a compilation of many sinner's prayers in the Bible. We remember the woman caught in adultery, thrown at Jesus' feet. He said, him without sin cast the first stone. And we remember, beginning with the eldest, they all left. And Jesus looked at the woman and said, where are your accusers? And she said, there are none, Lord. She calls him Lord. When you call God Lord, you're implying you're a servant. And I believe this is when Jesus said, then go and sin no more. I believe this is a really important part of our Christianity, to understand, whether it's the thief on the cross saying, remember me when you come into your kingdom. We deserve to be up here, but Jesus has done nothing wrong. He said to the other thief there on the cross, and he said to Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom. Jesus said, today you'll be with me in paradise. Now, we find other places throughout the Bible where we find that, whether it's Paul on the way to Damascus to persecute Christians. And when he went down and God set him straight, he said, who art thou, Lord? And Jesus said, I am Jesus whom you are persecuting. So when we look at all these, we realize that in the Bible, if we take the verses that the Bible says we need, if we confess our sins, he's faithful and just to forgive us our sins, cleanse us from all unrighteousness. We combine that with, as an example, when Jesus taught the disciples to pray, your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. When we see that God writes our name in the book of life, this is also added into it. So there's not actually a sinner's prayer, but it is a compilation of biblical verses. And so it is 100% biblical. A person coming to Christ has to be introduced to Christ. There has to be an initiation point. And so for most people, that is there in that very first prayer. Oftentimes they will pray. Your thoughts, Greg, on that topic?
Yeah, you know, that comes up occasionally. I remember, you know, when years ago when we used to go to Harvest Crusades all the time, being in San Diego, you'd be able to go to the one in San Diego, the one in Anaheim, and more up the coast, and there would be those zealous people standing out front, you know, with big signs saying, you know, there's no such thing as a sinner's prayer. You know what crusade evangelism does. You know, you're just inoculating people to the truth, and you know, to some extent, I can kind of understand what they mean, and biblically, like you said, there isn't one verse that is an actual sinner's prayer. But I was just looking at Acts chapter 3, verse 19, and it says, repent, therefore, and be converted, that your sins may be blotted out, and that times of refreshing may come from the presence of the Lord. And when Greg Laurie or Pastor Mike Kessler or what Billy Graham used to give invitations, all we are doing is having people you know, confess with their mouth that Jesus is Lord, and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. We are just giving people, when I do an invitation altar call, I don't always tell people to repeat these words after me, but to take ownership in their own heart, because it's an issue of the heart, and it's not an issue of what exact terminology you use or what exact words you use. It's a condition. It's a repentance in heart. It's a recognition of our sin before a holy God, and knowing that we have separated ourselves from being able to have fellowship with him, and realizing that heaven is a perfect place and God can't allow sin to be there. And so we repent of our sin. We acknowledge our sin. We repent of our sin. We turn from our sin, and we don't just turn from our sin, we turn to Jesus and we follow him. So like Pastor Mike said, there's no one specific verse that we would call the sinner's prayer, but there is a conglomeration or a compilation of the principle of surrendering your heart to the Lord. And that, you know, can a mute person receive Jesus as their Lord and Savior? We've had people, you know, ask those kinds of questions as well. And of course, it's a condition of the heart. And I'm glad that God knows how to read those much better than any human being can. Does that help?
Amen. Does that help? Hope it does. God bless you. And I'm sorry we got disconnected there, but we did want to address that for you the best we could. Now, we'll go ahead and go to Tim in North Carolina. Hi, welcome.
Well, thank you for taking my call here. I had two questions, actually. First one's about depression and handling it. I've had a problem with depression a good chunk of my life. I'm 72 now, and feel like I'm starting to go downhill, and well, been going downhill physically and mentally, and the doctor has me on a couple of antidepressants, which do help some, but you get some days when you just don't want to be here anymore, and I just wonder if there's any verses or any people in the Bible that were really dealing with depression that I could get some growth going here.
Sure. And depression is always so depressing. But, you know, I think it's what we focus on. I think anybody going through depression, you need to spend some time reading the book of Philippians. Now, you have to remember that Paul wrote this book to the church at Philippi. And this is where he was beaten as an uncondemned Roman, put in prison. That night, the earthquake came, all the doors swang open, the jailer was going to kill himself, and he didn't, because Paul yelled out, "Do yourself no harm, we're all here." Then the jailer said, "What must I do to be saved?" And we remember then the jailer took him home, cleaned his sores, brought him back, and then the next day the magistrate said, "Oh, let him go." And Paul said, "Wait a minute, you beat a Roman uncondemned. You're trying to be a colonial city here, Philippi, and this is the way you treat Roman citizens?" They were scared to death. The magistrates were absolutely terrified. So they came down and pleaded with Paul to leave. But Paul didn't pack up and walk out. He went back to Lydia's house and left on his own conditions, interestingly enough. But Paul writes this letter of encouragement to his friends he left behind there, from prison in Rome. He writes this letter in prison, encouraging us to have joy in our heart, not according to our circumstances. And I would say to anyone that has problems with depression, go read the book of Philippians. It's like the best medicine you can get. Your thoughts?
Yeah, I think that we can, Tim, number one, we just want to say thank you for calling in and sharing your heart and being honest and transparent and vulnerable. And I bet Pastor Mike would admit, and I know that I would admit, that we get attacked to be discouraged and overwhelmed and depressed all the time. You know, Christians are not immune to struggling and fighting, you know, back against depression. So number one, I just want to tell you, Tim, brother, you're not alone. You're not alone. And you're 72 years old. You have so much. If you've been walking with the Lord for a period of time, Tim, you have so much that you would be able to invest in and disciple younger men. So focus on that. Focus on the fact that God still continues to want to use you. And you know, when it's time for me to go home, or Mike to go home, or you to go home and be in the Lord's arms, you know, hallelujah. That's the goal. But in the meantime, the Lord doesn't want us to have any of those thoughts that might rush that process. You asked about, you know, are there any verses? And Mike said, yeah, read through Philippians, because it's the book of joy. The guy's in prison, and yet he's talking about his joy being full. You know, when I've been tempted to struggle with depression, here's my go-to verse, Tim. And anybody else out there who might be struggling with some of that, it's actually three verses in Psalm 61. And King David, man, that guy knew a little something about depression. He was constantly being persecuted. He was constantly being attacked. And he was constantly being condemned for the decisions that he was making. And here's what he says. This is Psalm 61, verses 1 through 3. And he's crying out to the Lord. He says, "Hear my cry, O God. Attend to my prayer. From the end of the earth, I will cry to you. When my heart is overwhelmed, lead me to the rock that is higher than I." And then he goes on to say this in verse 3. He says, "For you have been a shelter for me, a strong tower from the enemy." And in verse 4, it says, "I will abide in your tabernacle forever. I will trust in the shelter of your wings." So the enemy wants to remind us of our problems, and the Lord wants to remind us of our promises. And so, Tim, we just want to encourage you today. God is for Amen. You. God is for you, and God wants to use you. And the enemy is a liar. He's a liar from the beginning. He's the father of lies. And when he continues, because he's not going to give up wanting to discourage you and overwhelm you. But I'd encourage you, memorize those three or four verses. And when you start feeling discouraged, you just cry out, just like David did. You know, very often David would do that. And he would say, "Hey, Saul, why are you downcast?" So here's a godly man, the man after God's own heart, and he was discouraged like that. So, Tim, you're not experiencing anything that your brothers and your sisters around the world don't experience, but we have to fight back. That's what Charles Spurgeon said. He says, "I suffer depression more than any of you, but the way that I get over it is that I fight through it." And what he meant when he said he fights through it, it means that he just is reminded that his name is written in the Lamb's Book of Life, and that he is a son of the Most High God, Tim, just like you are. So, brother, keep your eyes on Jesus, the author and the perfecter of your faith, and maybe Pastor Mike could pray for you now. That sounds
yeah, Tim. Let's pray. Father, I just pray you lift Tim's heart, and Father, that you would cause him to focus on things of your kingdom, that you're not done with him yet. I think many of us that are older, we feel our usefulness is gone. And I would just pray that you would show him, God, that you put a life of experience in him to share with others. And I pray that you put him where he may be able to share those experiences that he's had, whether it be in church or a family that doesn't have a father. But Lord, that you would give him, God, that encouragement that comes from you in turn, so he could encourage others with the encouragement that he's received from you. And so, Lord, just pray you would protect him. Lord, you'd cause joy in his heart and let him know it's only the beginning. In Jesus' name, amen. Tim, stay in line. I'll send you some books, some DVDs, the movie Jesus, some things I think will really lift your heart, okay?
Well, thank you very much. Yeah, feeling overwhelmed, that's a good word for it there. And there was one other thing that, listening to your show yesterday, talking about what language will speak in heaven.
Yes.
And, I was involved with Bible translation, worked with a translation group for 30 years, and we knew there, actually, we're all going to be speaking Chinese when we get to heaven, because it takes an eternity to learn it. So
there you go.
That's a girl. Hey, Pastor Mike, can I mention one more thing?
Sure, go ahead.
Yeah, you know, I just again, I'm humbled by the fact that Tim was willing to share with, you know, the hundreds of thousands of people that listen or are watching right now. And, you know, if you're out there and you're going through something like Tim is going through, just call somebody that you know, somebody who's godly, and let them walk through this battle with you. Let iron sharpen iron. And we were never designed to go through this alone. And if you don't have that person, call into the show. We would love to pray for you and give you encouragement and remind you that God is doing good things in your life. That's probably why the enemy is attacking you and discouraging you to feel overwhelmed. So we love you, Tim. We love you, buddy.
You know, I heard the devil was having a yard sale one time.
Yeah.
And there on the table, he had pornography and he had weapons and he had all kinds of drugs. And a person stopped and was inquiring about something that he had behind the table that wasn't for sale. And he said, "What is that?" And the devil said, "Well, that's depression." And the devil said, "As long as I've got this one, I don't need any of the other ones." And it's true. More people are paralyzed in their Christian faith by depression, I believe, than any other one thing. And it's simply a lie from Satan, because that's the way he works. He's the father of all lies, and he knows what to say to us. He's had 6,000 years experience observing mankind, to cause us to go into depression. "Well, you should have done this. You should have done that. I wish you would have done this. I wish you would have done that." Always trying to drag us into our past. Now, our past is something that we can do nothing over. But when we look in the future, we look at a risen Savior, we look back, not at the things we've done wrong, but at the cross. "For this reason, Christ died." And so we can't live our life in regret. You live your life right now from where you are right now. And that separates us from the things of the past, the depression, and the things the devil can throw at us. The Bible says he's the accuser of the brethren. And the Bible says God don't listen concerning a Christian. So he doesn't get anywhere with God, so he comes down and accuses us to our face of the things we've done that causes his depression. "Oh, you should have done this. You should have done that. Your life could have been so much more." The thoughts are endless. Don't listen to him. We have been called by God. Jesus said, "My sheep know my voice." Condemnation is from the devil. Now, conviction is from the Holy Spirit. But once we're convicted, we repent. Hey, listen, there's the blessing that we have in our life. So don't let the enemy rip you off, Tim. Live for him. Stay in line. I'll get those books, DVDs out to you. I know you'll be blessed. Okay?
Okay. Well, thank you so much, Jared. I do appreciate all you guys do. And just for the encouragement. And you know, I got my little notes here so I can go over things. So, yeah, thank you so much.
God bless you. And then in the movie, in the DVD, Evolution versus God, if you go to special features, there's another set of movies in there as well. So you get quite a few you can watch there on your player there. So get those out to you, Tim. God bless you. Keep looking up. Our redemption draws nigh. Let's go to Daniel, Connecticut. Hi, welcome.
Hi. I have a two-part question, if I may. The 144,000 witnesses, are they... do they evangelize from the four corners, or by the time of, or are they evangelizing from Israel itself?
Well, you know, that's a really good question. As an example, are all the 144,000 evangelists, Jews, that are there in Revelation chapter 7, are they all in Israel, or are they scattered through the earth? I think it's a really good question. Your thoughts, Greg?
No, I think that they're going to go throughout throughout the entirety of the earth. The Lord has put put a seal on their foreheads, and they're going to be 144,000 Jewish evangelists like this world has never seen before. And I don't think that they're going to be confined to just the land of Israel. They're going to be all over the planet, because it says that they're 12,000 from each of the 12 tribes. So it doesn't say anything about them being specifically in Israel. They're already scattered throughout the world.
And they have a seal on their forehead, so everybody in the world recognizes these are set apart for God's purpose. Hope that answers. Stay online. We'll get you out some books, DVDs. We're out of time. Thanks, Greg. God bless you all. Good night.
To find out more about this ministry or to receive a copy of today's program, please call 1-800-357-4226 or write us to Every Man an Answer, P.O. Box 391, Twin Falls, Idaho, 83303. That toll-free number is 1-800-357-4226. Subscribe to the free podcast on iTunes by searching for To Every Man an Answer in the iTunes store, or visit us online at csnradio.com/TEMA. To Every Man an Answer is a production of CSN International, the Christian Satellite Network. The opinions expressed by our guests may or may not be those of CSN International or of this station.